Well, a well warm call to all of you. I'm really glad that you're willing to come to listen to me and other speakers about sustainable development. I know it's a hot topic, or that many people are interested in it, and what I will try to do is to also define it and relate it to the issue of innovation, which is a topic I'm working on. If you ask me what kind of scientist are you, I would say, well, I'm an innovation and transition researcher. I was originally trained as an economist, but I think I moved away from that. Okay. If my voice gets too low, you should just say, indicate that I should speak louder. Because there's no microphone. I will not talk about the science of climate change or the problems of biodiversity or the phosphorus cycle, you know, which all constitute serious environmental problems. What I will talk about is innovation for sustainable development. And I will do so as part of a broader lecture in which I will, which is about sustainable development. And I will try to make the argument that sustainable development is something we probably never can achieve, because it's really about, you know, the way that we like the world to be, and this is going to be an unending endeavor in a world in which every product or process will have an environmental impact, and in which people will want different things. So that's one of the arguments I will try to make with you. And what I very much would like to have is a kind of discussion with you. Also would like people in the audience to discuss with each other. So, I mean, I suppose you came here to learn something. Well, I also came here to learn something, not just to say something to you. If someone wants to say something, you know, please sort of raise your hand, and I'd like you to come in. So we'll have a kind of interactive sort of hour. I will plan to have a break. I think you probably also will appreciate that, and I hope to have a break in about 1 hour. Before the break, we'll have something of a discussion, I suppose. And after the break, we'll have more time for a discussion. With that, I'll just shift to the second slide, which is about sustainable development. Because if I'm going to say something about sustainable, I should also define it. Well, there are many definitions. You're probably aware with the definition of the Groenland report in a book published in 1987, Our Common Future, which says that sustainable development is meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Well, I think that's very lofty and very general. Sort of a more specific definition can also be found in this book, which says that sustainable development is a process of change in which many things are being in harmony with each other. The exploitation of resources, the direction of investments, technological change, institutional change. And that they not only benefit current generations, so the needs of the people living now, but also those of future generations. Well, if you think about this definition, I think you can identify two elements in it. The first element is a concern about conservation, or about staying within ecological limits, not going beyond the carrying capacity of natural systems. And secondly, there's a concern about creating more welfare, especially for the poor people. Well, my translation of that is that it's about protection and it's about creation. It's pro-development, but it's also pro-conservation. And these things all, you know, quite often don't go together very well. And that also makes sustainable development, well, you can say it involves a paradox or it involves certain dilemmas. Those who are interested in sustainable development usually can be put in different groups. There are the conservationists who sort of put the emphasis on conservation, and there are those who are more interested in or who value in economic development more than the conservationists. Well, this is a definition which considers sustainable development as achieving some kind of balance, a balance between economic gains, such as jobs, economic wealth. That's the economic dimension. There's also an environmental dimension, which is to be considered. And this is about maintaining a stable resource base, and also not polluting the environment too much, because this is harmful, to natural life, but also undermines life-supporting functions that we as humans also need. Clean air, clean water, things like that. And there's also a social element, or pillar, as it's often called, and this is about equity and about social services. It's interesting that in this definition, and that also manageable levels of debt are being included as something which belongs to sustainable development. And this is a definition from 2000, and I think this was quite prescient, because I think, today we have with very high levels of debt, we're also having serious problems for development. Well, others frame sustainable development somewhat differently in moral terms, and they say that sustainable development is not just about achieving some kind of balance, it's a moral obligation. It's about doing things which are responsible, and also making sure that hunger is being eliminated and that everyone has access to basic services. So here we have something making a moral appeal. And others have developed this further by identifying or defining certain sustainability values. So here it's not just, I can read them for you. I mean, but I think you also can read them for yourself. It's about tolerance, it's about compassion, it's about recognition of rights of others, including those of non-humans. And it's about respect for, what's been called the integrity of natural systems. There's also the value which says that we should recognize interdependencies between humans and also between humans and the natural world. This is, I think, probably the last one on sustainable development, because I may spend too much time on it. People oftentimes make a distinction between strong and weak sustainability. In strong sustainability, you don't want to accept ecological losses. Whereas in the case of weak sustainability, we say, as long as they're compensated by greater wealth or something else, it's okay, it's still sustainable. Does anyone want to say something at this point? No? I don't know what your definition of sustainable development is, but I would want to say to you that it's not just about what is, but it's what ought to be. So it's something very normative. And something that is normative also is subjective. And for societies then, sustainable development really is about the social consensus, about things we consider unsustainable, and also our ideas about progress, something which will differ across places. So if it's normative, it's also political, you can say. And that also brings up all kinds of issues about governance, so about who's deciding and so on what basis decisions are being made. Well, sustainable development also has been applied to issues of energy or sectors or domains of energy and other types of domains. And it's interesting to compare the different definitions. In the case of energy, for instance, we have a positive definition of sustainable development. It's actually positively defined in that renewable energy is considered sustainable energy. In the case of transport, we don't have such a situation. You know, sustainable mobility is usually defined in sort of well, less negative aspects, such as less congestion, less pollution, which is interesting that in this particular case, we don't have a clear definition of what sustainability means. In the case of agrofood, so agriculture and food consumption, we have quite a strong disagreement among also scientists about what sustainable agriculture or sustainable agrofood is. And so 2 weeks ago, I think there was a news item on television, I remember seeing, where the NOS, which is the Dutch broadcasting company, said that the University of Wageningen has established that intensive farming is sustainable, whereas organic farming is not sustainable. Well, this was, I mean, for me as a scientist, was quite interesting. Also from the viewpoint or how the media covers scientific issues, because the University of Wageningen consists of many different scientists, all holding different views and having different expertise. It just so happens that the head of the University of Science had a very strong conviction that intensive agriculture was desirable to feed a growing world. And he made himself known. And with that, he immediately got into conflict with sort of many of his professors, who actually wrote an open letter to him in which they strongly disagreed with what he just had been said. Of course, he had a valid point too about that you need to feed the world, and there's an issue of how to do this. But he framed it in a particular way. And what I would like you also to consider is that there are always different ways of framing something as sustainable and unsustainable. I could give more examples, but one other way of framing it differently is, for instance, by saying, well, if we don't throw away so much food, we also need less land. Intensive farming also can be done in a sort of a more sustainable way, more environmentally sustainable way. Issues which sort of didn't get expressed by the head of Wageningen University. I mean, I got quite interested in the issue of knowledge production and the role of science and also the authority of science in this. And I would like to share with you is that on many issues, science cannot sort of be the ultimate source of knowledge, simply because science is inadequate in fully researching a particular issue, especially when it's about the future. And what happens, or when there's uncertainty, or when sort of moral values are involved, in such circumstances, you have different viewpoints which can be considered perfectly reasonable. Of course, you know, as humans we may have our own viewpoint, but I think it's wrong to say of someone else's viewpoint that this is completely unreasonable. And I'll give you a few examples, one of which is climate change. Well, I mean, I'm someone who believes that climate change is happening. But others, the climate deniers, as they're usually called, they're not willing to believe that. And they have also their own sort of, their own knowledge or their own sources of information that they adhere to. Even the scientists who believe in climate change don't state that there's a 100% certainty that climate change is happening because of greenhouse gas emissions which come from human activity. Similar to the issue of geoengineering. Not sure if you know what that means, but that's one way of dealing with climate change, by sending particles into the atmosphere or fertilizing the oceans as a way of capturing CO2. Well, that's, for some this is a solution to the climate change problem. For others, this is just something which is probably creating more problems than it's solving. Did I say something funny, or you're watching something else? sorry? No. And equally with nuclear power, you can argue this is an issue for risk management, or something which, you know, we simply should not do because it's too risky. Well, on all these issues, I have a position, but I can also see that the other one has a position. And I think it's important to keep that in mind. On the issue of frames, I mean, here's an example of two different frames on being sustainable. There's one person who's consuming little, and there's another person who's consuming lots of environmentally friendly products. So, I mean, to conclude that sustainable development in the abstract is a set of nice words, or the definitions are a set of nice words, but it's rather universalist. When it's being translated in practical action, it's highly contested, simply because people want different things. They have different frames, they have different, well, values, and also things that they want for themselves and for society. Well, that raises the issue whether sustainable development is whether this is a useful term or not. I think you can argue both ways. A more positive way of looking at it is that it makes us reflect not just on the environmental sort of problems as defined by science, but also about our needs and priorities, where we want to go, and to what extent that is what that will mean in terms of the natural environment. It also makes us reflect about long-term effects, especially long-term system effects, which often are not very clear. Risks which are associated with particular technologies, and also whether a gain in one area is associated with cost in another area. So it makes us reflect about problem shifting. And it makes us think about this, you know, political choices, about reforms, whether we want to seek improvements within existing systems or make deep reforms. As an innovation researcher, I'm fond of saying that sustainable technologies do not exist, that sustainable development cannot be realized by a technologies or a set of technologies. I'll hope to make that more clear sort of later on. I mean, for me, sustainable development is something which we always have to be concerned with, because any type of development will be associated with some kind of problem, and that the solution probably lies in multiple decisions rather than in particular technologies or, you know, changes in business and so on. And my original title was Sustainable Development Requires Multiple Transitions, and I will sort of go into that for the next 10 minutes. But before doing that, I would like you to show these two quotes: that for every complex problem there's a solution, which is both, well, which is simple and neat, but also wrong. I haven't read this myself, but I came across it. And there's a quote from Joseph Schumpeter, who's a famous innovation scholar. He more or less established the field of innovation studies, who said, "One has to make up one's mind whether one wants simple answers or useful ones." And that really speaks to me. I mean, I don't believe in simple solutions. So I will now say something about different transitions, which I think are needed. And I will start with capitalism, which I think is a good one to start with, because, well, it's at the focus of attention. Well, it's often focused or considered the culprit of the economic crisis. And I think there's a kernel of truth in that. But it's also contested, of course, especially by economists who love capitalism. And I mean, I'm an economist too, so to a certain degree, I can also love the element of competition, and I can also see that it's serving consumer needs. But at the same time, I'm also aware that it's predicated on greed and also fueling desire. So it's contributing to consumerism and materialistic lifestyles. And as we know now, it's also a source of instability. One only has to think of the financial crisis. And it's interesting that also, you know, very famous people like Danny Roderick, who's a development economist, is arguing for different types of growth. There's a very nice book by Jonathan Porat, which I also can recommend. It's called Capitalism as If the World Matters. And that's really an insightful discussion of the environmental problems and also the workings of capitalism. Well, he's a lifelong environmental scientist, yes? I didn't get that, sorry. As if the world matters. He wants to make the argument that it should indeed be more focused on sort of real needs of people rather than just the consumer needs. Of course, capitalism is not an organization. It's an economic order. Sort of it relies on markets for the coordination of economic decisions. And, it doesn't, I mean, I don't want to go into the economic jargon, but it serves individual needs, and it's ill-suited for serving common goods. But it can be made also to serve the common goods. So it's also possible to let capitalism work for the benefit of all through the use of eco-taxes, for instance. Well, there's also the development of fair trade as a market-based type of development, which is, which you can consider as something positive. Did I answer my question or not? I will say a little bit more about what business is doing for sustainable development. Even though there will be the second presentation will go more deeply into that. I don't know what your view is about business, whether they are responsible or not. But business is doing quite a lot in terms of sustainable development. I mean, they have cleaned production processes quite often for economic reasons by being more resource efficient. They've produced greener products. They have systems of corporate social responsibility, and they also engage in charity work, you know, as an organization by giving money or by having business employees being involved in community activities. Well, this is some information about corporate social responsibility policy. And this is for the biggest companies. And you can see that the vast majority of the companies are involved in many aspects of corporate social responsibility. Things like health and safety, 96% of the companies are engaged in that. Corruption prevention, labor rights, climate change, 63% are involved in things to reduce, for climate change. And they also have policies of education and poverty reduction. And if you look at the motivations, yes?
Global companies, American companies, companies.
Yeah, all over the world, also American companies, yeah. But if you look at the motivations...
Sorry, I have one question on the slide before. What is the second column, so the quantitative targets about? So what is this?
This is about whether or not they have quantitative targets. Rather than just, which means that they want to achieve something. So they have set themselves certain targets, which makes it more of a consequential thing. There you see that, the numbers are lower. It's very high in the case of health and safety, where they probably have targets like, we want to reduce our number of casualties and things like that. In the case of climate change, 55% of the companies, the big companies, have quantitative targets. Now, if you look at the motivations for this and for sustainability actions, and this is a McKinsey report, maintaining or improving corporate image or reputation is the most important reason. And what I'm taking from this is actually that what they do is very much meant to save the existing business, to do things which are in a way which are a little less damaging than before. There's also something called new growth opportunities, new markets and products, and of course you have to look more deeply into that to investigate what that means. But my view of this is that it's the companies have their old business with which they want to continue, and this doesn't go for all companies. There are many examples of companies, especially young companies, who are doing something different. But perhaps I'm too negative here about companies. Rob Bauer probably will say other things. But in my view, corporate social responsibility probably is not really the mean for achieving something, for bringing us closer to sustainable development. It merely contributes to incremental change. So I think they would have to have a more offensive innovation type of approach to really make a contribution to sustainable development. And, well, I won't read all this, but you can see it's pretty negative about corporate social responsibility. And of course, there are also, you know, good reasons for why companies are behaving like this. Yeah, I don't want to, pass a kind of moral judgment on them. They also, they're in competition, they have to satisfy their shareholders and so on. Well, I already mentioned fair trade, which if you look at the numbers is pretty impressive. I mean, there's been a tenfold increase in the value of fair trade. I don't have the most recent number. I think it's still growing. So, I mean, this is also part of capitalism. Capitalism also involves a financial sector. And with a well-developed financial sector, it's possible to also to get loans. And it allows business and people to go into debt. And, the debt issue, I think, is also something to consider. I would like now to say something about transitions in energy and mobility, and I won't go very deeply into this. In the field of research I'm in, we talk about sustainability transitions. And in the case of energy, that means moving to renewables. In mobility, it means moving to, well, alternatives to car use, on greener cars. And in waste management, it means waste prevention, recycling, and reuse. There's also resource efficiency and being more responsible as a cross-cutting challenge for all of the transitions. And, what I would like to do now is to present a number of innovations to you. And before doing that, I would like you to have a look at this typology, in which is relatively simple. It's based on two dimensions, creating four categories, in which on the horizontal axis we have technology or knowledge, which can be incremental or radical, and on the vertical axis we have those innovations which are disruptive, different in an institutional or behavioral sense, and those which are not. And an example of an incremental innovation then is, which is one of the categories, is improved wind turbines. An example of a transformative innovation, which is both technologically and institutionally disruptive or radical, is the smart grid. An example of an incremental innovation in a technological sense, but a radical innovation in a social sense, is organized car sharing. And then we've got cradle to cradle, as it's not really well fitting into the scheme. So I've just positioned that as disruptive, but technologically it's neither incremental or radical. In my work, and I think also in discussions about sustainable, transformative innovation is often sort of brought up as something that will bring us closer to sustainable development. And I think that this is an interesting category to look at. And on that, I would like to say that here we're talking about systemic changes, not about a technology or a sort of a single innovation, but really something which is which goes beyond companies and involves different knowledge technologies which is radical also from the viewpoint of users and from the viewpoint of suppliers. And I'll give you some examples of that. I mean, this is in Germany. This is in a town close to, the Germans will know. It's not far from Wuppertal. It's It's a converted factory. So it's an old factory which is being converted into a place where people live, but also work. It relies on a heat exchange system for heating. It's well connected to a public transport hub, to Düsseldorf. So it's between Düsseldorf and Wuppertal. And it's also close to an attractive green area called the Neanderthal. Socially, it's also interested in that different age groups are living there, sort of also elderly, young families, with small children, elderly people. And, well, there's also the element of a special loan scheme for eco-houses, which also made this possible. So here we've had something which in many ways is novel, but also quite attractive in different ways. This is a more technological example. It's the DesertTech initiative, which is about concentrated solar power. There's some pictures of that on the right-hand side. It consists of parabolic mirrors in that with pipes with oil, and then the heat of the sun sort of heats the oil, and this can then be used for generating electricity. Technologically, I think this is an interesting technology, and it's especially suited for places where there's a lot of heat, as in the north of Africa. Of course, in Africa, there's less electricity, there's not so much electricity demand. So those who came up with this idea consider this a technology for Europe, which is located in Africa. Well, it's interesting from a sustainable development point of view because you're creating wealth in an area where there's a need for it. Of course, it remains to be seen who gets wealthy. Yeah, it's most likely to be the elites. And that also sort of, helps to make the point that technology in itself will never deliver sustainable development. Well, here this system of concentrated solar power is being combined with other renewable energy sources. And as you can see, it's possible to exploit the wind where it's windy, the sun heat when it's hot, and there's also hydro and biomass locations which have been identified and which could be combined into something which is a kind of supra-grid for renewables. Well, this is an example from the Netherlands. It's about bike-train integration, where people combine the use of a train with a public bike called the OV bike, which is available for people for renting. You may have seen them. Last year 1 million trips were made with OV bikes, and it's quite a success. It's let's say a low tech example of transformative innovation. Well. It's an example of intermodality, and intermodality also can involve the combination of the use of buses and trams and so on. And it could also be further developed into something where there's better information and booking. This is just to make the point that we should be thinking about systems about rather than particular technologies. Well, this is mobility management as something as in a companies could do in making a contribution to sustainable mobility through flexible working hours, and also by making available mobility cards to the employees. This is an example of cradle to cradle, where products are designed in such a way that all the different components can be reused later. I mean, it's called an example of biomimicking in the sense that it mimics, nature, where of course you don't have waste. You always have cycles. So what's waste becomes food for something else, and it's something that also could be applied to products. And several companies are interested in this. This is an example also from the Netherlands. It's called the Energy Producing Greenhouse. It's kind of iconic in the Netherlands, the iconic example for the energy transition. It's about storing the heat into sort of special aquifers, sort of water areas, and sort of which then are being used for cooling and also for heating. So rather than sort of opening the windows when it's getting too hot, so that the heat sort of disappears, it's being stored. So this shows you what's possible technologically, and this can be used to heat the greenhouse, or it can be in winter times, and it can be used to heat buildings. This is an example. This is called vehicle to grid, where battery electric vehicles are being used to store not only as a storage technology. So they, batteries have to be charged for people to use them, but I mean the batteries also could be used as a storage technology, and this may also help to stabilize a renewable based power system. I can say more about the examples if you want. This, in my sort of way of thinking, this is carbon capture and sequestering, which is something which is huge technologically, would qualify as a techno fix. So it would allow, basically sort of users to, continue with their current practices. It's just that the carbon, is no longer emitted, but is being stored either in the ocean or in special geological layers. So what this means is that sustainability gains can be found both within existing systems but also in alternative systems. Fossil fuel use can be made more sustainable by being more efficient in terms of use, by what the Americans call weatherproofing of homes, or by capturing the carbon. But it can also be found through a sort of alternative systems, and examples of that I've just shown you. Not sure how interesting this is for you. I mean, this is for transition research, this is an interesting slide. It says that transformative innovation is about social technical element, and that it's dynamic. And the dynamic aspects of that, I think, are sort of well illustrated by public bike schemes, where you may have a mobility card, you may have company bikes, you may also have electric bikes, which become available. And ultimately, public bikes could can become an alternative to cars, something which they're currently not. Public bikes could be available for park and ride sites. So there are many sort of ways for this to develop that further. Of course, you need suppliers and you also need users. And quite often, that's where, if you need both, and that may create a kind of chicken and egg problem. I'll ship that. I also wanted to say something about renewables having certain problems in terms of the land requirements and the use of critical materials. And that's just to make the point that, sustainable technologies is something of a problematic notion. and that we should not consider that we actually have two challenges if we're going to become sustainable, which is one of which is to shift to alternative technologies, but also make sure that the values and consumer criteria change. And the second challenge, of course, creates a problem for the first challenge, which is already difficult enough, because we have what economists call an unlevel playing field. We have a world which is organized around products and technologies which have gone down a learning curve, for which I think we have well-developed systems of supply, users who are, whose users adapted to that. So this is also why transformative change is difficult to achieve. I should speed up, because otherwise I will be talking more for more than an hour, which I don't want. Well, about the transition in governance, it's clear that we also need changes in governance and decision making. And one thing I would like to see is that also these alternative systems of provision get more attention. Also decision making is less dominated by the incumbents' invested interests. I will now be saying something about values and sort of about you and me, and that's by saying something about a transition in values, which I think is also needed. And the book of Jonathan Porritt is quite a good source for that. Where he makes the argument that we also should become less materialistic and also develop a kind of ethos of sufficiency. And in it, sort of he quotes the results of studies by someone named Kasser about materialistic values, which are quite telling you something. I mean, there's been psychological research about people's happiness and so on. And what this research shows is that people with materialistic values have actually a lower personal well-being and also lower psychological health. They also have less stable relationships, and they tend to be dissatisfied with each other, with themselves. Apparently, there's even a correlation between watching television and being unhappy, and I think it has to do something with the kind of role models that you sort of compare yourself to. So, well, I'm just showing this because I think it's relevant for the discussion on sustainable development, and I also think that the results are quite fascinating. Well. So if we're becoming sort of less materialistic, that's you might say a transition for everyone, as a person. And of course, less is always difficult. I mean, more is always, in many ways, is more easy. What needs to be done in order to become less materialistic is also to consider the positive side of that, which means that if you're less materialistic, you have to work less and you also have time for other kind of things, more meaningful things or other meaningful things to do. So sufficiency also can be considered a positive. Well, this is about the transition in lifestyles and habits. Which are relevant from a sustainable development point of view. And I think it's about things of being less, being more mindful, you know, better work, family balance, doing things that that are meaningful, as the kind of things which are truly important. Well, I as a person also have to look at this list in order really to be able to do this, because I think this is probably the most difficult transition for anyone. The way we are. We once had a lecture by Bill Ries here in Maastricht, and he's the one who came up with the ecological footprint. He's a biologist by training, and he was giving a lecture with the title, "Can Homo sapiens is Homo sapiens able or capable of being sustainable?" And his argument was that you know, the way we have evolved, you know, as beings, we probably can't. I mean, because we have reptile instincts, and you know, we have sort of, you know, a drive for instant gratifications and so on. And I think our capacity for moral behavior and so on is a kind of late development, and it's often overwhelmed by these other emotions. So some conclusions. Well, first of all, sustainable development is about us. It's not something, you know, it's not about others or about technologies. I mean, it's about us in sort of in every possible aspect, about the way we live, our values, you know, what we want to achieve. I also would like to say that as the Holy Grail, you know, everything together at the same time, it probably never can be reached, and it's an ongoing quest. It's also a difficult concept for policy, because it's so normative, and because well, it's not only about win-win for everyone. And, well, innovation is important for it, and there are many innovations, I think, which are interesting and worthwhile to explore and also to implement. But, again, it's not about innovation only. And I mean, my own view is that we should, you know, that we should be guided by visions of progress, which involve an element of wishful thinking, which is good to have, but we also should not have too much of it. We also should be mindful about possible negative aspects that also will occur. And I would like to end sort of this talk, which I've prepared for you, with a slide from a management book, which is about organizations, changing themselves. And he uses penguin, and this is from the book, about penguins on an iceberg that is melting. And as you can see, one of them says the iceberg is melting, and I mean, not every penguin may accept it, but I think let's assume a fair amount of the penguins sort of are accepting it. What happens is that, you know, they all have their own sort of specific petty or whatever concerns, just like human beings. And I think that's really, I think, the situation we're in, you know, for better and worse. You know, we're like penguins. With that, I thank you for your attention. You've been very quiet. you know, I hope there's something for you, that is interesting, and I'm happy to take some questions before we break for lunch. And so, who would like to say something?
I have a question about one of the last slides. I think it was personal change that we can be making. It said slow time. What is
Yeah, well, it's by living, you know, slowly. I mean, slow sex is part of that, but that's No, it's also not, you know, just not hurrying, not flying to other parts of the world, and it's I'm not practicing it myself too much, but it involves things like sort of you're really into the things that you do, and you're not necessary. I think being less materialistic is part of that. And there's also a slow food and sort of movement, where I think people also grow food and are involved in cooperation when it comes to that. So, well, that's what I can say about slow time.
Isn't it, in my opinion, like one sentence that is to live slowly is really, like you said it in a slow sentence, in a short sentence, that it's really living in the present without being rushed from the past and the future goals you want to reach, so really be there, and then automatically you are slower because you're not rushed with all the past stuff in your mind and all the future goals you want to reach. That's in my opinion.
I mean, when we think about sustainable development, we should not necessarily think about sort of lower environmental impact, but simply about a better life. And maybe the term better life is, you know, is in many ways a better term than sustainable development. You're first.
I'm a bit confused because on the one hand you argued that technology is not not the solution, but on the other hand you showed us lots of solution innovations that are based on technology. So.
It's important, but at the same time I want to say that the things that technology certainly cannot achieve, and with technologies, I mean technologies have the unpleasant habit, that they also create problems. So even when there are solutions for one problem, they often create other problems. Of course, some of them are more risky than others. And in my view, I think we should opt more for sort of, let's say, safe technologies. And I think solar power, I think, is relatively safe and more than, other energy sources, and whether they're carbon-based or nuclear. Yeah.
I'm interested in the effect of culture. And it just as one very small example, in the United States, if you go to the supermarket, you're given a choice between plastic or paper bags. And you're given them, and if you're in district, you have to buy your own bags, or you get charged for a bag. And I'm curious about how you adopted that in Dutch culture, whether people still resist that in some way, or what did Dutch society have to go through before that was accepted, and is it accepted?
Well, I mean, I can't give you a single reason, but I think there's been an old value that you should not throw away things. I think this was at the beginning of the environmental movement, which was very much anti-consumption, and it also helped also to put in place a system of waste management, which is very sophisticated. It's probably one of the best system of waste management that we have in the world. So it's culturally rooted, and it's also interesting that when Shell wanted to sink an oil platform, that this was so much in sort of conflict with the as their way of waste management, so much in contrast with this deeply held value that that's not how you deal with waste, that it causes a big trouble. I mean, it experienced consumer boycotts and sort of environmental actions And it decided not to do that. Even though the engineers had calculated, it was perfectly okay to sink an oil platform and let it sort of in the ocean. So that shows the power of values, I think. But of course, I mean, there's still a big difference between values and behavior. I think changing behavior, that's probably is going to remain a really difficult challenge for everyone. Yeah?
Well, speaking of cultural changes, they go in the other direction too, because I had a conversation with some 20-year-old friends of mine a few years back who were just raving that they could go to Topshop or one of these stores and buy a $5 pair of jeans, wear them once, and throw them away. And I thought, my God, you can't think that way. And that certainly is a cultural change for the worse that I'm feeling went a lot faster than the cultural change for the better of using fabric bags instead of plastic bags.
No, I agree. And I mean, I'm a parent, and I can't say I've always conferred the right values on my children. I mean, I also support them in developing a high mobility lifestyle and so on. But often things are going in the wrong direction, and I think that's important to consider. I mean, I've been talking about the transition to renewables, but I think what we're actually experiencing, although there are some developments into that direction, is a transition to non-conventional fossil fuels. Shale gas, and tear sands being used for oil. And I think that's deeply troubling, because these non-conventional sort of fuels are more environmentally damaging than the other ones. But they're very powerful sort of economic interests behind them, and also they fit quite well with the big consumer interest. That's an issue where I think I'm deeply concerned and where I'm absolutely not optimistic. Because, look at Alberta. That's a province in Canada. I mean, they're just producing oil in the most environmentally damaging way. It's not forced upon anyone that this should happen. I mean, this is just a market-led development, which is also not government-supported. Fossil fuels are very, as an energy source, they're very attractive because the energy is packed, and it's the result of millions of years that we have the fossil fuels, and we're burning them whenever we can. And I think as individuals, we're also in a way reproducing or helping to reproduce that kind of system, and if I wouldn't use it, someone else will. So I mean, that's the deeply troubling problem here. Talking about penguins. One more before we have a break.
Yes, we were talking a lot about product innovation and different ways of production. And I was wondering what your evaluation is with regard of business model innovation or entire business model innovation with regard to sustainable development, especially maybe to buffer the negative effects of technology or something to that they might have about that there might be the chance that complete new ways of business models in a more like disruptive way to go back to the basics might have a positive effect on buffering the negative effects of the technology.
Yeah. I mean, there's lots of positive examples that you can give. The business people also are quite active in that. I think the next presentation will show more examples of that. But if a product is more expensive, I think the solution is does not come from green products, which are more expensive. And they need special, I think, functionalities for them to be attractive in order to diffuse more widely. I mean, product sharing makes a lot of sense from a consumer point of view, but from a business point of view, I think it makes less sense. Because they're selling less products. On the other hand, I mean, an interesting example of a business model, which is in a way it's very funny. There was a Dutch company was making money from helping other companies with making energy efficiency improvements. So they would say, well, you know, you will take a certain share of the kind of of your savings, which is an interesting business model, which also, you know, was valid economically. And then they went into a company, and they helped to save it a big amount of energy and money through very simple means. And then they charged this company according to what they had agreed to, and the company had to pay 200,000 euro for really simple changes being made. And then the company refused to pay this. So sometimes it's possible to make a big, to create these kind of business model. And I think it's really a challenge for also the young people here to find those kind of business models. But it's not always easy, of course. It's especially the transformative innovations, which look nice as an idea, but you know, economically, that they often don't look very nice. Certainly not at the beginning of their development. So you need people willing to put money in it and sort of in a sustained way. Or you need special places and circumstances for those kind of systems to develop. But sometimes things move quickly, but more often they don't. Are there more questions? We can also stop. I mean, do you want to break and sort of come back? Or, maybe we should continue for maybe 5 more minutes. Because I somehow sense that I've already got most of the questions. Yeah.
Well, perhaps I'm the oldest student, but there are a few competitors. I came specially to learn something about the interaction of the system, the triangle from cradle to cradle. I was at several meetings where people explained how to work with it. And they always started with technical things, this and recycling and so on. And then I said, but there is a third angle in the triangle, and that's called equity. And we in Dutch we have translated that for rechtvaardigheid.
Yeah.
Rechtvaardigheid, it's a word.
Yeah.
And I said, so please, can you tell me something about sustainability and rechtvaardigheid, equity? And there was a young lady who was giving the lecture, and she said, sir, that's a problem. We have no idea how to tackle it. If you can help us, yes, I came here to hear from you how you do it. And I learned, I went to other meetings, and I asked the same question, and nobody has an answer. So please, if you have an answer for me, then I'm very glad to have made the journey to Maastricht.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a value issue for everyone. But I think that the example of Great Britain is quite interesting, also the way it's been advocated. Because I've also went to presentations about it. And it's being advocated by people who say, consumption is good, no problem. Had to consume. All you have to do is make sure that that, let's say, the consumer product at the end of its lifetime gets dismantled and the elements will be used again. Well, I don't know how you receiving this, but I mean, consumption is good. We just seen happiness statistics, which show you that actually consumerist lifestyle actually not making people sort of more happy. But there's another issue as well, which is that okay, you may design a product in a way that it can everything can be reused, but will it happen? And for that, you also need it also needs to be economical, or it has to be regulated. So. I mean, I'm not so optimistic that this is something that will bring a lot. I mean, it's nice as a principle, and I think as society we probably indeed have to close material loops. But I mean, the way it's been sold now, also by saying, well, you know, we should not worry about consumption. All we do is cradle to cradle. I'm not buying that too much.
Excuse me, it's not cradle to cradle as a philosophy.
No.
It's only the third angle. Equity. What the hell do they mean with that?
Okay.
And I read the book several times, and they have two pages, I think, that's not realistic. It's also included in other chapters. But there is no consistent philosophy about what is equal. And I think it's important because I'm sure that if we don't do something on equity, then all the endeavor for economic and environment is in vain. That's my personal conviction.
I agree with that. I have no idea what they mean with equity. Maybe someone else does. But I mean, equity is, of course, is something also a personal thing for everyone. And I think also a lot has to come from people, being more responsible.
I think 95% of us, if you give an example, do you think that it is rectified or not? 95% have the same opinion. That's my
experience. But we don't behave according to that principle.
No, the higher in top, the less they do. Read the paper and look television.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think we're all like penguins, and I want to thank you all for your attention. I hope you also go to the other lectures. There's some good people from the university here who are giving these kind of lectures. This was meant to be partly an introduction into the topic of sustainable development, and a little bit more than an introduction into the issue of innovation. With that, I thank you for your attention.